Well, let me ask you a question, church. How many of you have ever left one of your Christmas gifts wrapped instead of opening it, and you just decided, well, you know, it's so pretty and so well wrapped, I think I'll just leave it wrapped up because it probably the outside is better than what's on the inside, or maybe you put a gift off in the corner and you forgot about it till next year. That's probably not very likely. I think everyone, if you're like me, you come down the stairs and you're looking forward to ripping those boxes open and revealing your gift. But you know, for many people, Christmas remains wrapped. It needs to be unwrapped. And so we're going to look into the story today of a man named Herod. He was the king of Judea. And the thing that hid King Herod's gift was unpreparedness. Let me ask you this. How many of you have ever been unprepared for a big moment in your life? Maybe you're a student and you have a big test coming up and you didn't prepare for it. I wonder what were the results? Probably not a good outcome there. Or maybe you're doing a job report, or maybe you are trying to interview for a job, but you didn't prepare for it. Usually the results are not good. How many of you, though, have not really prepared yourself for Christmas? In fact, maybe let me ask this question. How many of you have actually, you're prepared, you're ready to go? I mean, as soon as that turkey was consumed, the lights were up and you were ready to go. Well, listen, Christmas gift is filled with great joy, but unfortunately for so many, it remains a hidden gift and it needs to be unwrapped. And so we're going to talk this morning about being prepared to receive all that Christmas brings to us and all that God wants to do in our life. And we're not going to overlook this season a single gift that God has for us. And so we're going to be bringing a series about unwrapping Christmas. Well, this is a story that we're looking at today. About secret meetings, about international intrigue and espionage, and it includes two really powerful people, two world powers, and a lot of ranking officials, and a king who felt very, very threatened. So threatened that he decided that he was going to kill a lot of babies. He was going to commit murder, and we have two adults and a baby fleeing for their lives in the middle of the night, and they end up fugitives in a foreign land. I mean, that sounds like good material to write a wonderful novel, but the fact is it's true. Well, how do we know it's true? It's the Christmas story. And King Herod is a king, a historical king, and we know that he existed, and there were three wise men, we call them magi, that came from the east. And so we need a fresh knowledge, I believe, this Christmas of Jesus Christ and what he means to you and what he means to me. So let's make room in our hearts. You know, Benjamin Franklin said that to fail to prepare is to prepare to what? To fail. Isn't that true? God wants us, church, to prepare ourselves to have a wonderful, wonderful time of Christmas. But you know, I feel even more so this year that God has set himself to come to us in a fresh way. It's as though Jesus were being birthed in our hearts for the very first time, and we must be careful not to let that gift be hidden by the mundane or by circumstances, but we've got to approach Christmas as though Jesus were coming in our hearts for the very first time. We're going to sing a song this morning. The worship team has hung around. They're going to lead us in the song Joy to the World, because it talks about that very thing that we're talking about this morning, preparing room for him. Let's sing this together, Joy to the World.
Let her receive.
nothing like a good Christmas song to get us in the spirit for Christmas. How about maybe a little Deck the Halls now? No, I'm just kidding. The song says, joy to the world, the Lord is come. Let's receive her King. Now listen to this. Let every heart prepare him room. Let every heart prepare him room. What does that mean? What does it mean to let every heart prepare him room? What that means is that we must get ready for Christmas, because there's all kinds of busyness associated with Christmas. We often refer to it as the trappings of Christmas, or at least we used to do years ago. We'd call it the trappings of Christmas, and if we're not careful, that's exactly what they become. They become traps that keep us from experiencing the main thing, the main gift that God wants to give to us. And so he wants us to move in and totally present our hearts to him and to receive everything that he has for us in this season. The church, I believe with all my heart, and I hope you do too, I believe that this year God has some really special gifts for all of us, for his church. And, you know, some of it's going to be a surprise. I remember about 43 years ago, my wife and I were living on campus at Azusa Pacific University. I was in graduate school at that time and working a full-time job. And I'd have to come home from work and grab my backpack. And out the door, I'd go to my first class, sometimes barely able to get any food. And so I was one of those nights I was running a little late. The traffic had slowed me down, and I ran in. I said, honey, I don't have time for any food. I've got to go. And I grabbed my backpack. She said, wait a minute, I need to talk to you. And I said, no, I've got to go. Can we talk later? And as I was going out the door, she said, we're going to have a baby. Well, after she applied the smelling salts and I woke up, you know, well, not actually, but it was almost to that point where, you know, I was just totally surprised and completely unready for that moment. Of course, it brought a lot of joy to our hearts, but you're not ready for such an important moment as that. And God wants us to be ready to receive, because there are consequences to us if we're not prepared, if we're not ready to receive all that God has for us and what God wants from us. Well, we're going to learn some really valuable lessons from this story today about King Herod and the wise men that I think will help us in our preparation, because King Herod was known as a great builder. Those of you who have traveled with us to Israel, we've looked at many of the buildings that were built by Herod during Herod's reign, and you know that he prepared for those buildings meticulously. He would plan every detail for the buildings, but he failed to plan and prepare for the most important event in human history. And he was unprepared. Because he was unprepared, he did some things that really were catastrophic. I mean, he tries to kill this Christ child because he wasn't prepared to receive him in his heart. And I think God wants you today, church. I think God wants me today to prepare our heart. That might mean that we have to flush out a lot of non-essentials, a lot of things that distract us and stuff our lives with things that keep our heart unavailable for what God wants to do. How many of you want to make room in your heart this year for a fresh gift of Christmas? I think we all do, and I can tell you that's what God wants from each of us. So what is it that God wants us to see? I think that God wants us to see that he's brought a new way. You know, the Lord is always bringing newness and freshness, and I think he wants us not to miss that this year with all of the stuff that's happening, all the circumstances, the COVID, the tension, political turmoil, and literally out in society, there's just turmoil everywhere, and he wants us not to be surprised and unprepared to like King Herod was, to receive something that is so important, maybe one of the most important moments you and I live in, one of the most important moments in human history. And if we're unprepared, church, listen, it can be devastating, not only to me and to you personally, but to our family and to our world. So let me take a moment to talk about some consequences of not being ready. Consequences of not being ready. First of all, when we're not ready, we live in fear. We're not prepared. We don't know what's going to happen. So we become fearful. Notice with me in chapter 2 of Matthew, verses 1 through 3. It says, now after Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea in the days of Herod the king, behold, wise men from the east came to Jerusalem saying, where is he who has been born king of the Jews? For we saw his star when it rose and have come to worship him. When Herod the king heard this, he was, say it with me, troubled. He was troubled, and all of Jerusalem with him. Well, what do you think he feared? Well, he feared the loss of his power. He feared the loss of his position. I mean, after all, he was the king, and if there's another king, he can only be a rival. He was preoccupied with power. He was addicted to power. He wasn't focused on what people need. He was focused on himself. He lived a very selfish life. And he's thinking, the last thing I need right now is a rival king, another king. And so he was kind of like the so-called king of rock and roll. Elvis Presley said he was all shook up. He was all shook up. Say that word troubled with me again. Troubled. What does that word mean? Well, actually, literally, it means to shake violently. To shake violently. His heart was not prepared, so his heart was shaking violently. He did not know what this Messiah meant to the world, and he was fearful. He doesn't know what's going to happen. He doesn't know what the future holds. And even the people bringing him the message cause him to be afraid, because these are, after all, very powerful people coming from the empire of Persia. They're wise men. They hold important office, and they're a rival empire. The two great empires of the time were the Persian Empire and the Roman Empire, and Herod was the puppet king of Judea, appointed by Rome. And so you got these two, the clashing of these two strongest armies in the world and the two greatest empires in the world, and Herod is thinking, this is my land, I'm the king here, and nobody is going to threaten my kingdom. Don't you dare threaten my power thing that I've got going on here. And so you might get upset with me for what I'm about to tell you, but I'm going to tell you the truth about the wise men. There were not three chubby little guys riding on camels, okay? So now don't throw away your nativity set yet, you know, but they were really very important, probably very fit people, very wise, very educated people. And the Persians rode on horses. They didn't ride on camels. They rode on horses. Often they would put their supplies on camels, but they were known to ride horses. We know that they brought gold, frankincense, and myrrh, so there were three different varieties of gifts, but we have no idea how many wise men there actually were. There could have been hundreds. We don't know. We know they all had gold, frankincense, and myrrh, because those were very valuable in that economy. And so they brought treasure to be brought to the new king. And they were the Magi. They were called the Magi. Now, we understand Magi because there's a very famous Magi in the Old Testament. His name was Daniel. How many of you remember reading about the prophet Daniel? He was taken in exile, first to Babylon, and he was educated. And it says he was a man of excellent spirit, and he grew and he prospered. He became the secretary of state of the Persian Empire. So a very powerful man physically and a very powerful man spiritually. And so these guys would have been of the same ilk. They were magi, they were educated, and they were bringing three gifts to be brought as an act of worship from the greatest empire in the world. Can you imagine the impressive entourage that must have accompanied them, because they would never have traveled alone, not in that world. They would have to have their servants, and they would have to have all those who would set up tents and provisions for them. And so now they come knocking on the door, and Herod's door, and they're saying, where's the king of the Jews? And Herod says, what are you talking about? I am the king of the Jews. Now, the details are not absolutely clear, but we can speculate that Herod did not receive this news well. In fact, not only was he afraid, but the scripture makes it very clear that all of Jerusalem were afraid. They had no idea what was happening and, you know, what was taking place, and so they were very fearful. Now, isn't it true that as a leader goes, so go the people? And so as Herod was fearful because he was unprepared, the people became fearful as well. Now, the second consequence of not being ready, not being prepared, is being insecure. Following right on the heels of being afraid is being insecure. When you're not prepared, you are insecure. Whether you are just starting out in a new business and you're maybe a carpenter, or and you don't have the right tools, or you're in the medical field, you don't have the right tools to do that. If you're not prepared, then you're insecure. And I love this about Herod, because this makes it so real for us, doesn't it? Because just like Herod, many of us fall in that same category. We're fearful because we're not prepared for the future, and we're insecure because we're not prepared for the future. So how do we know that Herod is insecure? Well, it's very clear here. He's worried about losing his position, and he begins a secretive investigation. Notice it says, and assembling all the chief priests and scribes of the people, he inquired of them where the Christ was to be born. So he gathers all of his peeps together, and he wants to find out where this rival is, and he wants to try to secure his position of power and authority. And so he's sending them out secretively to find. He calls his prophets together, tell me where this baby is supposed to be born so that I can eliminate the competition. And so there's lots of espionage and secrecy and jealousy and clandestine operations and assassinations, I mean, and envy. And it's all about real life, isn't it? I mean, that sounds kind of like the world that we live in. And the Bible is full of this kind of stuff. In order for you to get a hold of this stuff, you've got to read it. And, you know, I'm sorry, folks, the Christmas story is not just about silent night, holy night, all is calm, okay? There's a lot of chaos and there's a lot of murder and killing going on here. And, you know, sometimes you say, well, I would never kill anybody. I would never take anybody's life. But we kill people with our words, don't we? We cut with our defensive words. Now, notice next in verse 4 and verse 7, it says, then Herod summoned the wise men secretly to ascertain from them what time the star had appeared. And so the fear and the insecurity leads to another consequence. Another consequence of not being ready and not being prepared is practicing dishonesty. Practicing dishonesty. King Herod started to plan the death of a baby, of a child, and he tried to deceive the wise men into being complicit with him in this deed. Notice verse 8, it says, and he sent them to Bethlehem, saying, go and search diligently for the child, and when you have found him, bring me word that I too may come and worship him. So dishonesty is a consequence of being fearful and being insecure. You say, well, maybe he wanted to worship Jesus too. And I say, no, he's being completely disingenuous here. He's not wanting to worship the Savior. He's completely focused on himself. And this being focused on himself and unprepared to receive the gift of Christmas, it led him to living this inauthentic life, and he begins to deceive other people. But worst of all, he deceives himself. How many of you, let me ask this question of you, how many of you have ever been deceptive? You think of one time or many times that you felt justified in not being completely honest, but you deceived someone. Well, listen, you don't have to raise your hand, but I raise mine today. I have. Why is that? Because none of us are perfect, right? We are under, the flesh. We're in the flesh. The flesh is unredeemed, the temptations of the flesh. And so many times, because we're afraid, because we're unprepared, we live these unauthentic lives. We live these kind of, I can't tell people the truth. I have to be dishonest, because maybe if they knew the truth, they wouldn't like me. And so we hold back the truth. And, you know, sometimes we think we can even lie to God. Can you imagine that? As though God doesn't know the truth. We think we can actually deceive the Lord, and we resist him. And I think by looking at this story, we can learn a lot from this story about ourselves. So where have you not been prepared for something significant in your life? And what were the results? What was the outcome? What were the consequences of that? And I, you know, I've given you three, but there probably are a lot more than the three that you can think of. But I want to tell you that God has a gift for you in this season. And if you're not ready, if you don't prepare yourself, you're not going to receive a very important gift. So here's Herod. He wanted information so that he could eliminate the Christ child that was a threat to his power. So he begins to deceive the wise men, and he deceives himself. And there's so much going on in that season. But you know what? There's maybe even more going on in the season that you and I find ourselves. There's a lot going on here at the Highlands. Lots of ministry. People are still saying yes to God everywhere we turn. God is doing great things. He's helping us to be creative in new ways to reach out. And God brought us to this position, to this time, because he wants to accomplish his will. I was thinking about the story of Mordecai and Esther. Mordecai, who was Esther's uncle, Esther had been elevated to the queen, and she had this opportunity to speak out for her people. And so Mordecai encourages her and says, "Queen Esther, could it be that God has brought you to such a place, as such a time as this, such a position as this, for such a time as this? For such a time as this." I think, church, this is the time that God is calling you and calling us to respond. We can no longer afford to sit on the sidelines and just wait, because the time is short. How many of you believe that? The time is short. And so God has brought us to this time in human history, to this place that we are in human history, for such a time as this. And God is looking for people. He's looking for people. He's looking for people like you and people like me that will prepare their hearts to move in to the future, because what God is about to do is so amazing. We would not even believe it if God were to show us it in detail. We would not believe it. But it's so amazing. But our hearts have to be prepared. Otherwise, we're going to be lost in insecurity and fear, and we're not going to have the confidence. And we'll give place to dishonesty rather than the truth. So we can only do this when our hearts are prepared. The good news is, church, the good news is we can unwrap ourselves from all of the wrappings, all of the trappings that have shrouded us from what God is doing in the moment. He wants to just peel that back so that we can see clearly what he's doing and what our part in that should be, so we can recover from the consequences of unpreparedness. Isn't that good news? I mean, it'd be horrible if I just told you you're gonna be subjected to the consequences of being afraid and being uncertain and being unprepared. But the good news is that there are simple steps to unwrapping ourselves and experiencing the true joy of Christmas. So let me just quickly give you three secrets to being ready. You're going to want to have your pen and paper available, or get your app out and fill in the blanks. But these are three secrets to being ready. And the first is developing a disciplined heart. Developing a disciplined heart. The Bible says that these magi came from a distant land, about 100 miles or so away from the east. And we know this about the people in the east, the Persians, that they were highly educated. They studied continuously. They were known to be astronomers. They understood the galaxies, the stars. They were they studied prophecies like Daniel did. The scripture says about Daniel that he was a man, he was a powerful person. He could interpret dreams and solve riddles. And he was a man known to study well. Now, you can convince your mind quickly, but it takes a while to cultivate your heart. You can change your mind overnight. Have you ever done that? I've done that. Just changed my mind about something overnight. But in order to change your heart, it takes time of cultivation. And God wants to cultivate your heart. He wants to cultivate my heart for the season that we're in. He's looking for people that he can cultivate their heart. So God wants to raise up people who, like the soil in the parable of the sower, the right soil that seed can be planted in that will produce. Now, it took the wise men years to study and to identify a particular star, particular time, and to the prophecies that would go along with that place and that time. And they had to have hearts that were ready. And the secret to having a heart that is ready is a heart that is disciplined. Disciplined heart. A disciplined heart will do things because they are the right things to do. Not just because the heart wants to, but because they are the right things. Discipline is something sometimes just remembering what you want, what it is, what is your goal, what is it that you really desire, and staying focused on that. You know, because many times we forget what it was that we started out to do. One of the things we try to do here at the Highlands, God sent us out here in the Antelope Valley to help people say yes to God, and He gave us a strategy of loving, mending, training, and sending. And if you lose that perspective, if you get off on all kinds of other things that are not what God sent us to do, then you lose focus on the main thing. And you end up kind of drifting instead of really coming at it with a force. It's kind of like when you're driving your car, if you don't know where you're going, if you don't know the destination, any road will do. You could just go down any road. But most of us know where we want to get to when we turn the key in the ignition and start our car and pull out, and we know where we're going to go. So we take the road that we've thought out in our mind because we have it planned. Somebody said that if you don't have a destination, then any road will do. Well, as Christians, it is even more important that as we discipline our hearts, that we remember that God's will is what is best for us. After all, He is the one who created us. He made us like we are, and He has the perfect, He's created us for the perfect purpose, and you have your heart, and God has His heart, and it's really important that those two hearts grow closer together. But if our heart is filled with other stuff, if our life is filled with temptations and other desires and other distractions, then there's like a gap between our heart melding together with God's heart. But God wants to close that gap between our heart and His heart. And so our possessions and having things, and if your heart is full of other things, temptations, then oftentimes our heart is undisciplined. But here's what God commanded of us: put first the kingdom of God, and if you do that, then all of these other things will be added to you. So God wants His best for us. He wants His heart to be our heart, His desires to be our desires. And if your life is wrapped in distractions, if your life is wrapped in temptations, if your life is wrapped in possessions this season, then it might be keeping you from experiencing the joy that God wants you to experience. But it takes a disciplined heart to focus on that which is significant, that which is important. So the three wise men did not let anything distract them. In fact, it's written here in Matthew chapter 2, in verse 1 and 2, wise men from the east came to Jerusalem, for we saw the star when it rose and have come to worship Him. We didn't let anything sidetrack us. We set ourselves to do this thing that we saw and know is so important, so they stayed focused. So secondly, we need, if we're going to have a disciplined heart, we we're going to get free of the consequences, we need to search for sources of knowledge everywhere we can. I mean, how many sources of knowledge? I'm not talking just about your library. I mean, going after every source of knowledge that God has given to you. Many times, in a big way, it's the people around you. People who've had different experiences in life to draw from, people who have different gifting, different discernment, they have different expertise in certain things, and you can explore them as sources of knowledge. It really is going to require that we get to know one another. You know, that's kind of made very easy today because we can do that through the internet, and we can share and have life coaches and have mentors that we don't necessarily have to be face-to-face, although I think that's a very valuable thing to do. But I think we can easily acquire knowledge from other people by interacting through even social media. So we must connect with one another and have mentors and life coaches and spiritual elders. Because listen, God never created us to be solo individuals. God, the way God designed us is that we need each other. We're better when we have each other. Now, I know some people are more inclined to be alone, and if you're like me, you're somewhat of an extrovert, and you like sitting down at the beach all by yourself and just kind of reading a book or meditating on scripture or whatever, but there always is important that we be connected to our family, be connected to our spiritual family, and to people that can be a resource in our life. So that means we need to get involved in ministry. You either are unimportant, sitting on the sidelines, or you're going to decide, I'm going to be an influence for the kingdom. I'm going to take what God has shown me, and I'm going to share my story with other people. So the Magi examined the prophecy. They discerned it very carefully and what it meant. And the Bible says in verse 5, look with me, they told him in Bethlehem of Judea, for so it is written by the prophet, and you, O Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are by no means least among the rulers of Judah, for from you shall come a ruler who will shepherd my people Israel. After listening to the king, they went on their way. So they cultivated a disciplined heart. And then when you do that, you have to sustain it. You have to sustain it by tapping into ongoing resources of knowledge that God has put in your life, that he's made available to you. Now, the third secret of readiness, and I'll be very quick with this, it'll just take me a couple of minutes, is that we invest in the things that really matter. We invest in the things that really, really matter. Invest in the things that matter to God. Spend time and resources pursuing the things that matter in the long haul. You know, there are a lot of things that are important that matter in the moment, but more importantly, there are things that really pay off in the long haul. And the wise men invested their riches and their time and their effort in Jesus. Listen to what the Bible says in verse 11. And going into the house, they saw the child with Mary, his mother, and they fell down and worshiped him. Then opening their treasures, they offered him gifts, gold and frankincense and myrrh. Let me ask you this question as we finish today. What is untrained about your heart? What sources of knowledge do you need to access right now that you're not accessing? Where are you primarily investing your time and your talent and your resources? I want you to know that in this season, God is calling you and he's calling me to be ready or get ready. We must not, church, we must not dare be unprepared for what lies ahead. The consequences are amazing. They're huge. They're unbearable. We must ready ourselves. We've got to unwrap the gift, and in that gift is so much joy. We need to make room in our hearts for the Lord. I'm going to ask you to set everything aside. If you would, wherever you are, set your app, your PDA, or whatever, your phone aside. So your hands are open. Just put your hands there in front of you in a posture of receiving. Would you do that as we pray? Lord, we come to you today. We're your people. We change our mind daily about things, but Lord, we want you to cultivate our hearts for this season. We don't want to be like Herod, unprepared. We don't want to be afraid. We don't want to be insecure. We don't want to live dishonest, inauthentic lives. We want to be as the wise man that discerned the times, that figured out the riddles like Daniel, and solve complicated issues. But Lord, if our heart is constricted with so many cares of the world, we're going to miss that. and that'll be tragic. Lord, I pray that here at the Highlands, and all of those that are listening this morning would make this covenant with their heart that I'm going to have a disciplined heart. I'm going to focus on the things and the direction that God is leading me in. I'm going to focus on the things that really count, that really matter in life, to the kingdom of God first. And Lord, we just prepare ourselves and come before you and humble ourselves and say, Lord, forgive us for our wanderings. Forgive us that we've been so shrouded and wrapped that the gift that we are has not been released. And I pray for the releasing of the gift of people into this world today. We need people that are following Jesus, influencing this world. And I pray for that. And with your eyes still closed, nobody looking around, I'm going to ask if you would just ask yourself, have I received Christ? Have I been ready and prepared to receive Christ as my personal Lord and Savior? Maybe you haven't. Maybe you went to Sunday school all of your life, but you haven't really asked Jesus to forgive you of your sin. The Bible says that all of us have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. We deserve the punishment of our sin, which is death. But the Bible says the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ, our Lord. If you'll just reach out and receive the Christ, maybe for the first time for you, or maybe you've before, but you've gotten off track and you're recommitting your heart to Christ today and to his purposes. You're ready. You're ready for the future. And right now you would just say, Jesus, come into my heart. In fact, I'm gonna pray. And those of you who need to receive Christ right now, pray this simple prayer with me. Just say, God, I admit I'm a sinner. I know that I've fallen short of your expectation, the reason you created me to love God. And I deserve to be separated from God in death the rest of my life. But I want life. I want you to wash the slate clean, wipe it clean, and give me a brand new beginning. I want to be a part of the eternal family of God. I ask you to put your Holy Spirit in me. In Jesus' name, and everybody said, amen.